We have been studying the subject of sanctification for 3 weeks. And as I reminded, here is a very important subject related to the practical Christian life. At the same time, sanctification is a doctrinal subject. So it's an interface between doctrine and practice. As I discuss sanctification, there is a possibility that you might misunderstand that Christian life or practical Christian life is made up of only one aspect, and that is sanctification. You should not have that misunderstanding, because practical Christian life is made up of the interaction of a large number of factors in the life of a Christian. There is salvation, the threefold salvation. There is sanctification. Then there is growth and maturity. All of them put together, or as they interact with each other, they make a person what he is. Sanctification, as we studied, should not be seen independent of personal holiness and also personal growth. There is an interesting joke that I read the other day which illustrates integration in a very interesting manner. There was this very gentle king who was exceptionally gentle and kind to the people in his kingdom. He was known for his gentleness and kindness. But one day, one of his ministers committed a very serious, very, very grievous sin. So serious that even this gentle king finally had to order that the man be thrown into a fiery furnace. That used to be one method of execution. And the man started trembling at the thought of falling into a fiery furnace and him burning. And he pleaded to the king, "Lord, you are a gentle and compassionate king, and therefore I plead for mercy." And the king said, "Fine, for once I'll show compassion on this guy, and I order that he be burnt limb by limb. And now yours is the choice where you want to start. What would you prefer, my dear children?" Well, the man chose to be thrown into the fiery furnace as a whole. Okay? It's not possible. There are many areas in our life where it is not possible to isolate things and say, this is it. Rather, life is an integrated whole. And particularly when we talk about sanctification, that is very intimately related with Christian maturity, Christian growth and maturity. Sanctification is a part of growth and maturity, and as sanctification takes place in our life, if we don't grow and mature in our life, then this affects that affects this. One of the good examples is King David. If I ask you to choose a hero from the Word of God, probably many of you would choose Joseph, who was innocent throughout his life. You may choose Daniel. You may choose Daniel's friends. But perhaps many of you would not choose David, because David is a man whose life actually started, or the young life as he entered into rulership, it started with a very serious sin. But at the same time, do you realize that David is a man whom the Lord used to work in a very powerful way? And David is a person to whom maximum number of history or chapters in the Word of God are devoted. So much so that eventually God himself gave him a nickname. What is David's nickname? That's something I would love to have, but none of us can ever claim. I believe none of us might ever grow to that stage. David, a man after God's own heart. He grew into such an intimacy with the Lord, and the sanctification in his life was so intense that finally not man but God himself says that here is a man who was as carnal, as scheming as you could imagine, But he has grown so much, he has become so mature, and he shows so much separation or sanctification that he is a man after my own heart. That is what the eternal God says about this puny man. Is it possible? Yes, it is possible if we allow sanctification and growth to work in our lives. As we started our study, we saw that sanctification means separation. In the life of a believer, a separation is needed. Separation from what can be called as cosmos diabolicus, the diabolical world system of Satan. We also noticed that the separation comes at least in three stages. One, which we discussed last week, is positional separation, where at the moment of your salvation, the Lord unites you with Lord Jesus and his body, and God says Jesus Christ is sanctified, is separate, and therefore any person, including this new believer, who has been united with Lord Jesus Christ at the moment of his salvation, he is sanctified. And when I look at him, I see him as a sanctified being. This is something totally from the way the world operates. The world demands that you work hard and attain a position. God, on the contrary, gives you the position first and then expects you to work hard and show a life that is in keeping with your position. It's difficult to understand. Very difficult, because divine truths are often totally contrary to human wisdom. And it is very difficult to understand why God would give us position and then expect us to rise to that position. But that is exactly what is seen in the Word of God. Look at the prodigal son. Though he became a prodigal, he never lost his position. His father never disinherited him from the family, though actually he had taken away the portion that belonged to him. But he was always a son, prodigal or not. And as the son comes from a distance, two things take place simultaneously. Please pay attention. The son says, I will go, I will ask pardon, and I will say, Dad, make me a servant, make me a slave, and I will be happy. The dad, from a distance, spots his son and is thrilled, and he waits there so that the son may come and fall at his feet and apologize and make amends for what he had done in the past. Is that the way the biblical story goes? No. As soon as the father spots the son, forgetting all the dignity of his age, forgetting his position in that community, forgetting the fact that he slaves, and everybody might think that, oh, this man, what has happened to him? He is not following the protocol. He forgets everything. He runs to his son. He embraces his son. He falls on the neck of his son and he kisses him. The apology part comes after that. Did you ever notice? The acceptance part came first. The running to the son came first. The apology, the restoration, and everything came after that. That's a beautiful illustration of the way God works. God gives you the position first and then expects you to conform to that position. It was the same with the older son. He had a position in the family. And as the eldest son of the family, he had double inheritance. He was ruling the family in place of his father or as a representative of his father. But he had not understood any of these things. The younger one did understand. And this is what you and I, as Christians, as children of God, have to understand each day, that God operates in a way totally contrary, absolutely and totally contrary to the way man operates. We want people to come and ask forgiveness first, then we forgive. But when God looks at us, he looks at our heart, and if he feels that this man is going to change, even before the words of apology fall from our mouth, he comes, He embraces, He takes us. He is not even interested in words of apology, because He is looking at the heart. He knows that there is a change, and even before the words come out of the mouth, the Father starts giving order to His servants. One of the things which the Father ordered the servants is not meaningful in our society, Indian society, but in the biblical society, that had very serious connotations. He said, his boy was going to be given a bath, he was going to be given a haircut, he was going to be given a brand new robe, and they were going to slaughter the fattened calf. But hidden within the story, there is a little piece of command that is once again related to his position. The Father says, put a ring on him. It was not just their love for gold. It was not a fancy. It was not to show that I have a golden ring. Not at all. The ring there signified his position in the family. It is totally different from the way we use rings. That is the reason why in the Word of God, you often read that an impression of the ring was placed on a particular document. There, the ring shows the position. The prodigal son, no sooner he was spotted by the father, was immediately welcomed, his position was restored to him. And then the father expected him to confirm and lead a life according to the position that is granted to us. Brothers and sisters, as many of you listening to me have accepted Lord Jesus as your personal Savior, today you stand in front of God as sinners separated unto God, as people who have been sanctified, and that also once and for all. The question before we go to the second stage of sanctification is, have you as a child of God been leading a life which is in keeping with your sanctification? It's not an ordinary question. Don't take it lightly. You have been granted a position. Can you stand up and say that, yes, Brother Johnson, I accepted Jesus as my personal Savior 10 years ago, and I can say that I have been trying my best to lead a life that is sanctified? Can you say that? We often fail to see the relationship between position and behavior in Christian life. Let me illustrate with something from our social life. We all here in this congregation have been a big family, and after the meeting is over, we may stand here for a long time. We all would talk with each other because we are all a very big family, and I consider myself also as part of the family. Now, when I am in my house with my immediate family, there are times when I would be very casual, just a banyan and might be a lungi, because you are among your family members, you don't have to be formal. So next Sunday evening, when you come here for your message, you find me sitting with my bag and mic and attachment and all the paraphernalia, but then I claim that I am within my family. So today I decided that I am going here to Christian fellowship meet in my lungi and banyan. What's the problem with that? I'm sure that, though there is no problem with that, I'm sure that the responsible people here would definitely take me first for private counsel and then hand me over to a psychiatrist. A person who does not behave in a manner that is in keeping with his position is showing some kind of a split personality. What is called as schizophrenia. It's true that we are a family, but as family assembles on different occasions, each person has to behave in keeping with the position that he has. So let me ask you, before we look into the Word of God once again, as you go to your schools, my little children, when you talk to your companions and when your teachers look at you, are they able to see Christ in you? Are they able to see you reflecting the position that is in you? Or are you as profane as your companions? The older ones, brothers and sisters, the Lord has put us in different positions. Some of you are in teaching, some of you are in secretarial jobs, some of you are in administrative jobs, some of you are involved in business. As people come and deal with you, and as words come out of your mouth, and as you respond to difficult situations, are they able to see an integration between your words and your position? Or do they say, oh, Johnson Philip, in pulpit he poses to be a saint, but once he's in the classroom, you start seeing his feet of clay. And would people say, oh, we are happy that this guy who preaches, after all, he is a sinner like us, exactly like us, or much more profane than us. It gives us a lot of encouragement. We have been given a position, and now the Lord expects us to behave according to that, and that leads us to the second stage of sanctification. The first is positional, and the second is experiential. Whereas we saw the word of God saying that you have been sanctified once and for all, the same word of God also says that we have to be sanctified in our everyday life. Would you turn with me to Hebrews chapter 12 verse 14. Hebrews chapter 12 verse 14 says, Hebrews 12, 14, follow peace with all men. And holiness. It's the same word as sanctification. You follow peace, you follow sanctification, without which no man shall see the Lord. If you have been sanctified once and for all, what is the need to follow sanctification? You already have it, isn't it? Yes, you already have it, but what you have is positional, and now the Lord expects that you would conform unto the position that is given to you. That is the reason why, though you have been made it once and for all, at the same time, you have to follow it. And you have to follow it every day of your life. If you would turn with me to 1 Thessalonians, 1 Thessalonians 4 and 3. 1 Thessalonians 4 and 3 once again shows the everyday aspect. For this is the will of God, even your sanctification. My young brothers and sisters who have cleared their 12th, the question comes to them, but the question is an illustration to people who are older to you and also the younger ones. Many of you have cleared your plus two, isn't it? So this night when you go home, if your mom comes and says, son, after listening to Brother Johnson, I had a great desire that you should go and clear your 12th successfully, what would be your response? Mom, what is wrong with you? Isn't it? Or something like that. Something that you have already attained, people don't ask you to attain it once again. I cleared my equivalent to my plus two in 1971. That's almost 32 years ago. So tomorrow when I go meet my mom, if she says, Mone, last night I was praying that you may clear your higher secondary, that would be shocking. But when God speaks in the same manner, we don't have to be shocked. Rather, we have to see whether we understand it properly. Because in one place the word of God says that you are already sanctified. In another place it says that it is God's will that you should be sanctified. And it is stressing everyday sanctification. You can be sure that God is not man. He is presenting two aspects of the same divine truth. One, that you have once and for all, and two, that you have to show in your everyday life, or what you have to experience in your everyday life. Some of you young people have asked me, this is a question which I used to ask to myself, and at a later stage many young people started asking me, they would come and say, Johnson uncle, what is wrong with me? So I would say, yes, what is wrong with you? He says, my mom and dad, they say that when we try to do something that is wrong, there is an inner voice saying that, no, no, you should not do this, you should not do this, you should not do this. But Uncle Johnson, I don't hear a voice like that. So I ask, what exactly is the problem? You tell me the problem. So the first one says, Uncle, I'm in the hobby of collecting pens. So when I go to school or college, and when I see one of the pens, the pen of my friend, lying there unattended, I simply add it to my collection. And my conscience doesn't bother me. Many of you have experienced this. In fact, let's be blunt. All of you young people have experienced this, if not with pencil, then with something else. Your mom and dad or some senior fellow in the church stands up and says that the Lord has been speaking to me, and this has been happening to me, but as soon as I try to do this, my conscience bothers, and you say, what is this conscience thing? I don't find any botheration. I can easily pick up a pen as easily as I pick up a textbook. After all, I'm adding to my collection. You are not even willing to acknowledge that you are stealing. That's because you still stand at a stage in your Christian life where the sanctification has not come to a level where your conscience bothers you. That should tell you that you have yet much more to grow. And as we grow, we abandon many of our childish activities. A simple example, we have two young men in this assembly and in this auditorium, any meeting, and they simply roam around. Nobody worries about that. Nobody thinks that these children have some psychological problem. That's their age. At this age, if they don't roam around, then you have to worry about them. But suppose the young men and women in our choir, they say that if these kids can roam around, we can do the same. No, we don't expect that. And they are not tempted to do that. That's the most interesting thing. They are not tempted. If anyone of you is tempted, you can speak to me at the close of the meeting. As we grow, things that were normal and natural, we start avoiding them. They are no longer normal. So if you young men and women feel that, see, look at that brother or this sister, they say that when I do something, my conscience bothers me, and that doesn't happen to me. That's because you are yet to grow. As you grow, as you become spiritually more mature, and as everyday sanctification takes place in your life, for the first time, you would realize that no sooner you pick up the pen for adding to your collection, there's a fear in your heart. So far you were doing it boldly, but this time there's a fear. And perhaps you keep it back. As a teacher, I've seen this in dozens of my students. A boy or a girl who is so raw and crass, as they come, they feel that the whole class is their territory, and everybody feels that this guy or girl, they were schooled in chambal. But as months go by, you see the guy or girl not only becoming more quiet, they also start abandoning their lust for things that belong to others. And gradually a time comes when this boy, who used to check whether there is any pen lying unattended, he comes with two or three pens so that if somebody doesn't have, he passes on one to them. What's happening? He's growing. And as he grows, he becomes more mature. He becomes more sanctified. And now he's not interested in things of others. His conscience bothers him. This happens. But the rate varies. Some people develop a conscience very fast. In some, it takes a little time. There are a number of factors related to that. But it does happen if you allow yourself, if you yield yourself. This sanctification takes place in your life, and as the days go by, you realize that things which you enjoyed yesterday, you no longer enjoy them today, and things in which you delighted yesterday, they no longer offer you a delight. On the contrary, now you can relate to those persons who said that such and such thing bothered me very much. Now the same thing bother you also, because you have come to that level where your everyday sanctification, everyday separation, and along with that everyday maturity, which is not sanctification. Maturity and sanctification are different. They are related. Everyday maturity, it has come to a stage where your conscience has a powerful voice and powerful enough to restrain you from the things that you have been doing till yesterday without impunity, with impunity. And then as this believer keeps on moving in his Christian life, he reaches a final stage. Let us just jump to verses related to the final stage, and then we will come back to the second stage once again. Would you please turn with me to 1 Thessalonians 5:23. 1 Thessalonians 5:23. It says, "And the very God of peace sanctify you wholly." It is not talking about position. It is not talking about everyday sanctification. It is talking about a stage in our life when there is a complete sanctification or complete separation. That is also going to come. And that is in the Word of God, that final sanctification, when the Word of God talks repeatedly about that. And there is a very convenient term using which we can designate, and that is the ultimate sanctification. We have positional, where the Lord grants us a position. We have experiential, where in our everyday life we experience that setting apart of our life for the Lord or a separation for the Lord. And then we come to the final sanctification or the ultimate sanctification, where a person is completely and wholly sacrificed, sanctified. Oh, you may say, brother, isn't that talking about this life? Are we not going to be sanctified completely in this life? If you think that way, would you please turn with me to 1 John chapter 1 verses 8 and 10. 1 John chapter 1. It says, "If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves." In the Word of God, a phrase like "we" and "us," it stands for born again people. When the Spirit of God speaks through the apostle uses terms like "we" and "us" for the community of Christian believers. See, if anyone in the community of Christian believers says that we have no sin, we are cheating ourselves. We are deceiving ourselves. And if you would look at the 10th verse, if we say that we have not sinned, we make him, God, a liar. And his word is not in us. So if anybody thinks that within this Christian life, it is possible for a person to lead a life which is totally free from sinful activities or which is totally free from the presence of sin, he is going contrary to the Word of God. The Word of God says that sin will always be present in our Christian life. So there is nothing like ultimate sanctification or final sanctification in this practical Christian life. But when the Word of God talks about whole sanctification or ultimate or final sanctification or complete sanctification, it is talking about the third stage of the experience through which we are going to pass. So now we have in front of us the three stages of sanctification: positional, ultimate, and experiential. And as we look at the Word of God, it becomes clear that a believer cannot do for obtaining positional sanctification. That is something given by God. A believer cannot do something for obtaining ultimate sanctification. That is given by God. But once he gives something as your position, once he gives, and before he gives something as the ultimate, you have a period of time when you have been given this order to lead a life that is full of sanctification, and the Lord has granted you everything that is necessary to obtain this life. So the question is, how do we obtain that? Or how do we experience sanctification? Or how can we grow in our sanctification? But before I address that question, let me once again ask you this question. Can you say that from the moment of my salvation up to this point, which might be a month, an year, a decade, or more, can you honestly say that yes, all these years I have been growing in my Christian life in such a manner that my conscience has become more sensitive to the actions in which I should not indulge? That is the best possible question to test your sanctification. And therefore, I'll repeat once again. See, we need some kind of a standard using which we have to test. The best question to test whether you have been growing in your experiential sanctification is this. Can you stand up and say honestly, or can you say honestly to yourself, that compared to the moment when I was saved, I have been growing into such a mental state where things that were okay till yesterday are not okay today, things at which my conscience did not prick me, it has started pricking me today? Oh, some of you may say, uncle, at the moment of salvation, I'm talking about the younger ones, I was full of excitement. I avoided this, I avoided that, I avoided all this. But now that I'm into this engineering college or medical college, or now that I'm into this college, and now that I have such a fantastic company of people enlightened according to the principles of the world, I have no problem listening to a little bit of profanity. And I believe that if I have to speak the same words, I shall not be bothered. I know a number of young men and women who at the moment of their salvation observed rigorous separation from things of the world. But once they got into the company of their friends, might be in a professional or in a non-professional college, their lingo changed totally. What was unthinkable till yesterday is always on the tip of their tongue today. That is because instead of growing in sanctification, they have been compromising with it. But actually, if you are growing in your Christian life, every day you would find that you are becoming more and more and more increasingly sensitive to things which are not good for a child of God. Yesterday you had no problem, today your conscience bothers. If that happens, you are growing. If no, you have to examine yourself. So now that, and the older ones also should use the same test. You have been in the Christian life for a period far longer than what your children have been. Can you say honestly that, yes, Brother Johnson, it's been 10 years since I was born into the family of God. 10 years ago, I was a profane man. Or 10 years ago, I was a woman with a very short temper. I did not find it difficult to use any kind of harsh words against anybody, or I did not find anything wrong with this or this or this. But today, if I speak a single harsh word, today if a single profanity comes out of my mind, my conscience keep on bothering till I confess to the Lord that, Lord, a few moments ago I did something that I ought not to have done. If you have come to that kind of that stage, if you have come to that kind of an experience, that means you are growing in your everyday life as far as sanctification is concerned, and perhaps you are becoming mature also. If not, we have to very seriously examine ourselves. Christian life is not a game. It is not some kind of a crossword puzzle that you solve halfway and take pride in that and leave the rest. Oh, at least I have been able to come up to this point. No. Christian life is not a joke. It is a task. And you have to be doing it till you attain that level which the Lord expects from you. That is what Saint Paul said. The greatest man, the Lion of God, he said, I do not say that I have attained. No, not at all. But forgetting the things in the past, I press on towards the mark. He did not say that he has reached the mark. And he also does not say that I am happy that I reached up to this. No. I use the illustration of crossword definitely because I am sure some of you do that. When I see Indian Express, at the last page you have jumbled words. With my love for language, I try to solve those words. Often I am able to, out of the five, I am able to solve two, and they keep the paper away with total satisfaction that Johnson, you have been able to solve at least two. There are many around you who are not able to solve even one. Gives a lot of satisfaction, isn't it? You ask any of these young people here, padutha enganunda, kodupu illa. Standard lingo among Malayalis to justify their shortcomings, academic shortcomings. Well, in your academic life, that kind of an excuse would take you far, not in the Christian life. And if you are solving some kind of a mental game, well, you might have some kind of a self-satisfaction. Not in the Christian life. In the Christian life, you cannot say, oh, I am very happy, I reached 1/4. Forgetting the things in the past, I press on towards the mark, and till the moment that I do not reach the mark, I will never have satisfaction. That should be the attitude of a Christian. And therefore, the question now is, what is the method? How can I experience practical sanctification in my everyday life? There is a verse which all of you should underline, especially the young ones, and that is found in Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12. Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12. All of you should actually memorize this verse. It says, the word of God is alive and powerful. Sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of the soul and the spirits, and of the joints and the marrow, and it is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. Word of God pierces deep into your heart. And as all of you would have realized by now, ultimately it is our mind that has to change. If your mind is sanctified, your behavior will also be sanctified. If your mind is not set apart, howsoever you might try from outside, you will not show or exhibit a behavior in which there is separation. So the most important thing is, take care of your mind. And the word of God reminds us that the only tool, the only thing which can go and separate things in the heart is the word of God. And all of you should memorize this. The word of God is alive and powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of the soul and the spirit and the joint and the marrow. And it's a critique. It discerns, it separates. It is a discerner of the heart. How does it work? Okay, you will say, understood. The first stage is, the word of God is the principle, or the word of God is a tool that is going to work in our life for sanctification. But the question is, how does the word of God work? We find that in Romans chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. Romans chapter 12, verses 1 and 2, and here again are two verses which all the young men and women in this congregation should definitely memorize. I request you, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, wholly acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. What is a sacrifice? And what is the connection with sanctification? A sacrifice is something set apart, brought, and kept there on the altar for God and God alone, not for man. And it's a beautiful picture of separation. An altar or a sacrifice is not a picture of separation alone. Don't misunderstand me. It is a picture of a number of things. But here, when the Word of God says that we should offer our life as a sacrifice to God, it is talking one. It is talking of a number of things, and one of them is separation. You are no longer yourself. You no longer belong to yourself. You are no longer supposed to mingle with, or you are not supposed to be unequally yoked with unbelievers. A separation is needed. You have to take your life and offer it as a living sacrifice. You don't have to kill yourself. You don't have to destroy yourself. You have to offer as a living sacrifice, or in other words, as you live your everyday life, that separation from the world and unto God should be manifest. The second verse shows the procedure. It says, do not be conformed to this world. That is just the opposite of sanctification. Conformation with the world is the opposite of sanctification. Don't be conformed. Okay? Observe a separation. How do we do that? But be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may know what is the good, acceptable, and perfect will of God. What happens is this: as we allow the Word of God to work in our lives, the Word of God examines our thoughts. It critiques our thoughts. For the first time it says, Johnson, till yesterday such thoughts and such ones were mingled in your mind. You did not know that something is wrong. Today I want to show you, this part is okay, this part is not okay. For the first time I realized that, okay, things I used to do, I should do them no more. Things I used to think, I should think them no more. Till yesterday I thought it is okay to listen to a couple of profane jokes. As long as you don't speak, it's okay if you listen to profanity, what you young people call as non-vegetarian jokes. Today you realize that the Word of God says lusting in mind is as serious an offense as practical fornication or actual fornication. Today you also realize that blessed is the man who does not stand and who does not sit in the ways of people with whom he ought to have no fellowship. Things I used to do, I do them no more. Doesn't come by imposing some kind of a separation. It comes by an inner separation, an inner change. And that inner separation and change comes as the Word of God comes into your mind and shows that these thoughts are okay, these are not okay. And therefore, don't entertain these things, but this one is okay. Things that you enjoyed till yesterday, you would suddenly find that you no longer enjoy. You realize that it is not proper for a believer. Your mind is gradually transformed. And when your mind is transformed, you realize that you need to observe discretion. And you, as you observe discretion in your thought life, you would realize that you start observing discretion even in your practical Christian life. Sanctification is a vast subject, and we can go on and on and on. But during the presentation of this series, my aim was to present just the bare essentials and exhort you to study the subject by yourself. The best method would be, take a pen, and as you read the Word of God, whether it is the Old Testament or the New Testament, whenever you come across a command related to separation or holiness, just underline it. And my friends, my young friends, you are going to be shocked at the number of commands and exhortations in the Word of God which lead people to, or which expect people to, show sanctification in their life. Do you know, some of us use the names of pagan gods without any thought about that. Did you know that you as a believer, you're not supposed to mention the names of pagan gods, particularly in a manner where you endorse them. Did you know that? The only time when the Word of God allows you to mention a pagan god is in a situation where you are teaching or exhorting or rebuking people. In any other situation, if you mention the names of pagan gods with approval, you are going against the commands of the Word of God. Did you know that? Well, many of us did not know, don't know, because we often do not try to distinguish or discriminate between those commands that are related to everyday life and also our thought life. If you would look into the Word of God, you would realize that many of the things that we do casually, they are forbidden for us. So what you have to do is take a pencil or a pen, and as you read, underline, note down, or put a symbol there showing that this verse is talking about sanctification. And you would be surprised to know that many of the things that you speak are actually forbidden. Many kinds of clothing that you wear, you would realize that the Word of God doesn't allow. Many of the foods that you consume, the Word of God doesn't allow them. Many of the books that you read, the Word of God says it is not good for your health. Much of your friendship, the Word of God would say, show you that it is not healthy, it is not good, it is not wholesome. You would be surprised at the range of things covered by the Word of God, particularly in relation to sanctification, if you would look at the Word of God. It's a vast subject. But we are going to conclude today with a couple more observations from the Word of God, not because the subject is complete, but because at this stage an introduction would be sufficient. It has become clear for each one of us that once God gives us a position, He expects us to lead a life that is in keeping with the position. Now the question is, what are the factors which can adversely affect our sanctification? There are number of factors, but if you would just remember 1 John chapter 2 verses 15 and 16, that would be sufficient at this stage. 1 John chapter 2 verses 15 and 16. Verse 15, the first part says, do not love the world, neither things in the world. Is it saying, is the Word of God implying that you should not buy products from such and such company, or you should not indulge in wholesome things? No. When the Word of God uses world in this sense, it is talking about a system of thought, the cosmic world using which Satan is trying to control you. Spiritual compromise, material compromise, compromise in any aspect of your Christian life, ordering your life by the standards of the world instead of ordering it by the standards of God's word. This kind of behavior, or the philosophy which leads to this kind of behavior, that philosophy is called world. It is not this physical world. Jesus himself said, I'm not saying that you should not have any company, then you have to separate yourself physically from the world. When the Word of God says observe a separation from the world, it is talking about that collection of philosophies and ideas and ideals which motivate you to lead your life according to Satan's philosophy rather than according to biblical philosophy. It is from that we have to observe a separation. To illustrate that, we can go to the story of Daniel, where he was taken captive. Approximately 70 young men were taken captive, and they were going to be given the best in food, clothing, training, accommodation. The best of everything that was available. But Daniel purposed in his heart that he shall not defile himself using the food that was served there. Why? Well, he could easily have said, I am a captive here, and as a captive I have no freedom. The Lord himself has brought me here, And therefore, now it is the Lord's headache to see that everything is all right. This is a kind of philosophy that is widespread here. A few months ago, I criticized one of the magazines which many of you young people received. I had asked many of you to find out the reason why I strongly criticized it. There are a number of reasons, but I'll tell you one. It is related to your sanctification. In that, there is an interview, and in that interview, the person who speaks, she makes it very clear that she trusted in the Lord, and the Lord himself led her to a job where she is not able to go and worship with the saints on Sunday. So whose mistake is that? The Lord's mistake. The Lord has taken me, the Lord, I pray to the Lord, the Lord gave me a job where I cannot go to Sunday meeting, and therefore the Lord is responsible. That's a cosmos diabolicus, the false satanic system where you attribute to the Lord and you put all the burden on the Lord, though you are following the philosophy of the world. Sometimes back, I was counseling a young man who fell into a love affair. Well, as a time came when he realized that he needs to seek counsel. So he came and said, "Johnson uncle, how is it possible? How is it possible that this is wrong?" So I said, "Well, I'm not saying that it is right or wrong. That is something that we shall discuss much later. That can right or wrong comes only at a much later stage. But you tell me why you feel that it is the Lord's will." So he said, "Uncle, we had an opportunity to mingle with each other." Actually, this is a case where they had gone much, they had broken all boundaries between man and woman. So he said, "Uncle, practically today there is no boundary between me and this damsel. We almost lived as husband and wife without the knowledge of our family. But how can it be wrong?" So I said, "Okay, why do you feel?" That means, if you are asking that kind of a question, particularly you are an Indian, I don't expect an Indian to ask that kind of a question having lived in sin with that girl. Why do you ask that question? Then the cat came out of the bag. He said, "Uncle, it's true that we are not married, but we lived like husband and wife. But before we indulged, we prayed to the Lord that, Lord, if it is not your will, take away this feeling of physical attraction from us." I said, "Wonderful, wonderful. You have, son, you have gone a step ahead of everybody else. First of all, you prepared the ground. Okay, you prepared an environment. Then you emotionally got entangled. And then you allowed your lust to be fanned. You were sitting and fanning all the flames. And when the flame is at the peak, you are saying, Lord, if it is not your will, please quench the flames." Many of us order our lives not by biblical principles, but by using Satan's false cosmological system. And in that system, we justify everything. We justify the first stage, second stage, third stage. And finally, just after taking the plunge, we say, "Lord, stop it if it is your will." Like the man who goes to a pinnacle, he goes to the top of a mountain, and now there is a fall, which is 1,000 feet. He thinks at it, he looks at it, he knows that if he jumps, if he is going to die. And then he takes the plunge and now says, "Lord, if it is your will for me not to die, please protect me." That is what I said by justifying your actions till the end, till you take the plunge, and then you say, "Lord, if it is your will, get me out of this." Anyone who tries to justify spiritual compromises, spiritual inefficiency, by saying that the Lord led me into this, is fighting against God, and he is ready to take the plunge into the deepest kind of compromise. When a young man or woman says that the Lord led me to a job, the Lord himself led me to a job where I cannot attend Sunday meeting, he is attributing to the Lord something that he decided based upon the principles of cosmos diabolicus. Daniel could have done the same. He could have said, the Lord brought me as a slave. I have no rights and privileges here, and therefore I have to eat. Or he could have said, oh, if I eat this food and become strong, I can witness to the people. That is something used by a lot of people. In one of the meetings, I told you about a lot of young people in EU and EGF circles who have been living by this philosophy. I've counseled a lot of people. Now, as if I mention the name of any organization, don't think that I'm anti to the core. I'm a very active speaker in these circles. 10 years ago, when I landed in Kerala, this was some very widespread philosophy. Many of them came and asked, Uncle Johnson, is it okay to marry an unbeliever? And I said, what does the word of God say? Don't be unequally yoked. Then they would say, but uncle, even before I could finish quoting that verse, they would say, but uncle, if we marry an unbeliever, we can evangelize that person. Oh, so I thought, you came and asked me a question, not to find a biblical answer, but to convince me that I have to change my way of thinking. And then there was little, this lass studying in a college in somewhere in Uttar Pradesh, she wrote an entire testimony and published in Family Foundation magazine. A Muslim fell in love with me and he said, I want to marry you. So I prayed and I fasted and prayed, and the Lord said, yes, my daughter, if you marry that guy, you can go to Iran and evangelize Iran. So an evangelical magazine publishes. I became a missionary. I sacrificed my life and I went to Iran as a missionary, and the Lord has been using me. Wonderful. Tell me, if you go like this, where is the boundary? Where is the boundary? Anybody can justify any kind of sin. I can say that, you know, I have in the absence of my wife, I have a very good relationship with all the women in my neighborhood because I can evangelize them. And my wife can say the same thing. Oh, when my husband is not here, I go and spend a lot of time with the men in the neighborhood, leading them to the Lord. This has been done by Christians. This article that I'm mentioning, it was published not in an ordinary magazine, it was published in the Tamil Nadu EGF Family magazine, where it justifies breaking a command of the Word of God by saying that the Lord is leading me into this and that. If that is a justification, then any person can indulge in anything. The first thing, as we talk about sanctification, is not to justify your sins, not to justify the situation, not to justify the situation in which you find and say that the Lord is going to use it. Not at all. Whether it is something that is very small, very looks like insignificant, or something that is very significant, you have to remember not to justify yourself, but rather to examine it rigorously in the light of the Word of God. Daniel could have done that. He did not do that. We could do that, but we should not do that. First thing. So my young friends, as each one of you thinks about your sanctification, think of the way your friends talk. Think of the things they talk about. If that is a kind of conversation which is not proper for a believer, don't justify by saying that, oh, I am sitting there because once their conversation is over, I can share the gospel of Christ. What kind of a sharing? Tomorrow when you say that Jesus can give you a life, they will say, Johnson Philip, we know what you are. Till yesterday you were sitting here and enjoying all this conversation, and now you are sharing about God's holiness. They would say, you disappear. We don't want to hear. Brothers and sisters, any kind of indulgence which compromises our spiritual life is going to destroy the process of sanctification. Do you know why? Because all these compromises are leading us to order our life according to the philosophy of the world. The word of God in 1 John chapter 2 verse 16 says, all that is in the world, and then three things are mentioned specifically: lust of the flesh, lust of the eyes, and pride of life is not of the Father, but is of the world. Oh, you may say, brother, great. I don't indulge in lust of the flesh. Never in the lust of the eye. And pride of life. I am a very humble Christian. I am never proud of my humility. Let me ask you something. Many of you are very fond of television. I'm not trying to condemn television. If you have a television, I'm not advising that you throw it away. Don't do that. But what kind of programs do you see? Can you say that the programs that I watch do not manipulate the lustful feelings within my heart? I know for sure there was one particular channel which many believers in Kerala used to relish. In their conversation, they used to appreciate that channel. And a pagan, a female who does not know Lord Jesus as her Savior, who has no idea of biblical morality, threatened to put a full stop to that channel. Do you remember that? When Sushma Swaraj threatened, the fashion channel immediately changed from a soft pornographic stand to something that was less than that. And many, I know number of Christians in Kerala who used to relish that and who used to justify, Johnson, after all, we are trying to see what's the latest in society, else you will be outdated. It took the courage and the voice of a non-Christian to bring out the fact that this is pure commercialization of lust. Often we justify ourselves. Many of us, especially the ladies, are addicted to these family-oriented serials which are broadcast. But remember, many of these serials, they take a very light view of morality. Immorality is sometimes glorified in them. Often it is blessed. If you watch it, you must realize that subtle changes are taking place in your mind, your thinking, and your values are shifting in a subtle manner, destroying your sanctification. If you allow your young people to watch, tomorrow when they imitate the same thing and you say, son or daughter, it is not right, they would say, mom, how can you say that? And they would have all the justifications already available to them to defend their actions. Okay, you may say, brother, lust of the eye, lust of the flesh, in future we shall not indulge in them. But what about pride of life? Surely you are not saying that we are going to get into that kind of things? Brothers and sisters, in the life of a Christian, pride of life, these days particularly, pride of life is much more dangerous than lust of the flesh and lust of the eyes. Have you heard this statement? I often hear, somebody comes and says, I had a very serious problem in my life. I wanted God to work in my life, but God was not able to work. Do you know why? I had somehow bound God, and yesterday in my prayer I said, Holy Spirit, you are free to work in my life. I liberated the Holy Spirit. I made him free to work in my life. Have you heard this kind of statement? I keep on hearing. I bump into all kinds of Christians. So somebody comes and says, yesterday I heard one of these speakers and he said, Lord is not going to work in your, he is unable to work in your life because you have bound God. So I said, Lord, I make you free to work in my life. Abomination. blasphemy. That fellow who is nothing more than a worm in front of the eternal creator of the Lord, he says that the Lord was not able to work because the Lord was in my control and in my command. Most of the Christian television programs available today are promoting this kind of a philosophy, where you are encouraged to lead according to the pride of your life. I made the Lord free. I gave him freedom. I had bound him. Or the Lord came and said, don't bind your wife or husband. I want to work in their life. I said, okay, I liberate them. Or somebody else comes and says that, oh, before we spread the gospel in this town, we are going to bind all the spirits of darkness. Come on. Don't be stupid. Read the word of God. It says that even the archangel did not have the courage to rebuke Lucifer. He only said, let the Lord rebuke you. Don't break the protocol. Don't forget the protocol. You cannot bind God. The puny man is but dust in front of God. Don't let these programs manipulate you into a very high esteem of you where you think that you are God. I was reading the other day one of the statements made by Benny Hinn, very popular with spiritually juvenile crowd. He said, yes, I am God. Repeat with me, I am God. All the people sitting there in the crowd repeat, I am God. They could simply have gone to Exodus chapter 20, where God says, I will not share my glory with anyone, or any other passage in the word of God. My dear brothers and sisters, we live in a world where lust of the eye is very common. Avoid all those factors which fan the flames of lust of the eye. We live in a world where lust of the flesh is very common. You have to consciously avoid all those factors which fan the flames of lust of the flesh. But since such things are considered wrong in the Indian society, many of us try to avoid them. But when it comes to pride of life, many of us do not realize that the programs that we are watching, they are in a subtle manner, they are manipulating the pride of life. The last program that I watched, I often watch a wide variety of programs to know what is happening to the society. This man comes, he opens a very heavy leather-bound Bible and says, read this verse. Do you want to inherit the billions which the people around you have gathered? And everybody says, amen. After all, who doesn't want money that belongs to somebody else? And then he says, the word of God says that the fool hath collected money, the rich hath collected money so that the children of God may have them. And everybody says, amen, without realizing that appropriate. The word of God, or that is known as stealing. And the word of God says, thou shalt not steal, and thou shalt not even think of stealing. So let us come back once again to the subject. God gave us a position as separated people. Now he expects us to live a life according to that. And God shall one day sanctify us, totally separate us. But in between, there is a period, there is a substantial period where it is our responsibility to see that our life is sanctified. Not using human wisdom, not using human energy, but using divine wisdom in the word of God, and also by using divine provisions. Allow the word of God to work in your lives. Allow the word of God to transform your lives. Don't indulge in lust of the eye, lust of the flesh, and also pride of life. May the Lord bless you and help you to understand these things.